On to LANDFIRE now, and let's talk about how this particular program implements the concept of the departure metric, what LANDFIRE calls vegetation departure, or sometimes VDEP. So let's go to the same exact spreadsheet. I'll open the second tab that says LANDFIRE departure. Now, before I go on, I'm going to say this for the first time and probably many times during this presentation. For LANDFIRE, biophysical settings is the logical and spatial basis for the departure calculations. Again, biophysical settings for LANDFIRE is the logical and spatial basis for the departure calculation. Keep that in mind as we go through this over the next few minutes. So here's how LANDFIRE implements the departure metric. You see, the table is exactly the same now, but with LANDFIRE terminology. The rows in this table are now what we call succession classes. Percent of the landscape in each serial state for each BPS. Again, that importance of BPS. The two data sets to LANDFIRE are reference and current. Reference being pre-European colonization time period. And Randy's going to go more into that in detail later on this morning. But it's important to note here that this is not the only way to define your reference data set. Reference values don't have to be defined as past conditions. This is just how LANDFIRE develops its departure or VDEP value. The rules for defining these succession classes, the rows in this table, are provided in LANDFIRE biophysical settings, models, and descriptions. So that's where you go to find out how we classified A, B, C, D, E, F in the biophysical settings, models, and descriptions. You might wonder here why there is a class with 0% in the reference data set. Why is F even included? Well, F represents some condition that is possible now, but was not possible in the reference data. For example, pine plantations, introduced exotic vegetation, etc. If F occurs in the current data set, it automatically decreases similarity and increases departure. So what is current to LANDFIRE? Well, it's the time period represented by the LANDFIRE version you are using, and it's derived from that version's existing vegetation type, existing vegetation cover, existing vegetation height. And it uses the same exact rules we use to derive reference percents in the table. Corey's going to dive into those values, how those values are generated by LANDFIRE later on this afternoon. So therefore, for LANDFIRE vegetation departure, VDEP represents how different the distribution of succession states today is from the estimated pre-European colonization distribution of succession states for a specific BPS. So LANDFIRE VDEP is a simple coarse indicator of current ecosystem condition in comparison to pre-European colonization ecosystem conditions. So based on this implementation, I want to make it clear that LANDFIRE vegetation departure and its derivative vegetation condition class is not fire regime condition class, FRCC, nor is LANDFIRE VDEP VCC a direct measure of fire hazard by itself. Remember, VCC, vegetation condition class, is just the departure value, which is scaled from 0 to 100, sliced into categories that may look like FRCC, but it is not FRCC. We can talk about that later if anyone needs to have further information about why VDEP is not FRCC. The final key question we need to consider is, what is a landscape for LANDFIRE? Remember, that's percent of the landscape in each succession state. But what is the landscape? The landscape is what is technically called in the departure metric, the summary unit. Okay, so we're going to use that term quite a lot, the summary unit. The summary unit for LANDFIRE departure is national land cover data map zones that have the exact same reference condition for that BPS. It is at minimum a very, very large area and potentially a huge area. Okay, so let me repeat that. The summary unit for LANDFIRE departure is national land cover data map zones with the same exact reference condition for that BPS. It is at minimum a very large area and potentially a huge area. So that means the summary unit can be different for different BPSs. It's important to really understand that. So if you're not familiar with national land cover or NLCD map zones, in the spreadsheet you have, there's a map that shows the map zones. And the six geo areas that LANDFIRE uses to deliver data, but within them are a set of NLCD map zones. So you can see there are 66 or 65 of them, 66 of them across the nation. So at minimum, the summary unit for a BPS is a single entire map zone. And sometimes it's a group of map zones, okay? So how can you tell what the summary unit is for a particular biophysical setting? Well, it's actually embedded code and description name of that BPS. So I'm going to show you how to do that. I'm going to open www.landfirereview.org. I'm going to go to the Locate BPS tab. And I'm going to just type in some search text just here in a moment. But first, if you look on the left, you can see the different ways that you can search for biophysical settings by their basic vegetation life form type or by individual NLCD map zones. But I'm going to type in the word longleaf here and show you that you can search by particular text values. And so in this case, I've typed longleaf. So you can see this Florida longleaf pine sandhill has map zones 55, 56, and 99. That then is the summary unit for this particular BPS. For southeastern interior longleaf pine woodland, however, it's 48, 54, and 59. Okay. By the way, you can download these, just these two, or any of them that you've selected by clicking the box over here and by saying download selected documents. And you'll get those documents. And embedded in the name, it will be 13560 underscore 55-56-99. This one will be 13510 underscore 48 underscore 54 underscore 59. So to see the summary units, you look at the BPS code that is tagged on to the BPS name in the description. And just to give you an idea of what that means, so we look at 55, 56, and 99 for that particular BPS. And you see I've got 55, 56, and 99. So the summary unit for that Florida longleaf pine sandhill is this whole region of the country. So just to reiterate what the summary unit means, that everything is summarized over a particular summary unit. So VDEP, as LANDFIRE delivers it, likely represents differences in succession class over a much larger area than you're possibly interested in, unless you're conducting some kind of regional or national analysis. That's why we picked that summary unit, because that's what LANDFIRE as delivered is for. But you need to think about what summary unit is actually useful to you, because every pixel for a specific BPS within an individual summary unit has the same LANDFIRE VDEP value. Repeat that again. Every pixel for a specific BPS within a summary unit has the exact same LF VDEP value. And departure VDEP is very dependent on the summary unit you choose. This is called scale dependence, and Corey's going to show you an example of that later. Also later in this workshop, we're going to demonstrate how to modify LANDFIRE VDEP or develop your own departure metrics that might be more useful to you in what you're doing. As with all metrics, there are assumptions that need to be understood. So let's review them once again. And I've included a tab in the spreadsheet that goes over the assumptions of the departure metric once again. Here they are. The values for the different classes in the two data sets are accurate enough, and the variables represent what is important to you. So that's something to always think about. Is the data accurate enough? And does it represent what is really important to you? The two data sets being compared are compatible. Comparing them makes sense based on what they represent. So for example, in LANDFIRE VDEP succession class, in the reference values and the current conditions are defined in exactly the same way. It makes sense to compare them. And finally, the landscape summary unit is large enough to potentially capture the entirety of the class distribution that you're interested in, and is not so large that it washes out what you're really interested in. So that summary unit is really a key assumption of the metric that you need to be aware of. So there's the two quick takeaway messages. Departure is a simple ecological metric. It was not created by LANDFIRE. It was implemented by LANDFIRE in a particular way, but it is not the only way, and you may need to do something different.
So that concludes the first two parts of the workshop. So now I want to open it up for questions. I'm going to stop sharing and see if there are any questions about what we've talked about so far. See lots of chat, but maybe you're chatting among yourselves.
Yeah, Jim, we were talking about the size of the system and how do you pick a size of it? That you have a map unit that could be ginormous, but your system is not ginormous within that map unit. But what is it you can get away for size? And I was typing on kind of crude rules of thumbs, like along these systems like us that had fast return intervals, you can do a smaller systems. But right. Greasewood, which has long, exceedingly long return intervals for the major disturbance, you need like 1 million acres to actually capture your successional classes.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's actually, deciding on the right summary unit can be quite complicated, you know, depending again on things like you talked about. What is the distribution of the system? What is the disturbance regime? I think Corey's going to talk about that a little bit, about some of the rules of thumb that have been used in the past to define what your summary unit may be. Maybe it's a HUC 10, maybe it's a HUC 12. Maybe it's a national forest or a set of national forests or a ranger district or what. There are ways to think about it. And we can certainly work with anybody on that in the future that wants to have a conversation about what's the appropriate summary unit. But you're right, Louis, it's kind of a mess. I didn't want to get too deeply into it here. I knew Corey was going to talk a bit about it.
And it is a great question. I know something that I've talked with some of you about, and a challenge we face is when people want to apply VDEP to their favorite stand. You know, we call it my favorite pixel syndrome, something like that. I put a link in the chat that I doubt this is the first ever mention of minimum dynamic area. Maybe it is, but it's sort of, in my mind, what Jim's comments build on in terms of scale. You know, what is the area required to capture natural disturbances? And Louis gave some specific examples of that. And in our part of the world in the Northeast, you know, we're looking at northern hardwoods, which are driven, you know, that would be an ecosystem on, you know, fairly rich sites that would have sugar maple, yellow birch, beech, white pine. That ecosystem is driven by kind of small patch disturbances, blowdowns, disease, small bits of mortality. And so to capture all the succession classes for that ecosystem would be different than possibly looking at jack pines in my part of the world, which are driven by, you know, a fairly intense fire regime. So it's not super easy. And I think LANDFIRE went with just large, you know, map zones.
Yeah, we did. We went with something that could be implemented in a consistent way across the country. That was one of the criteria for LANDFIRE's charter, was we don't try to tell a specific message about a specific place. You know, we needed to apply a consistent methodology. And we felt like this was the, and I'm going to use the word easiest, most implementable way to actually think about summary units on a national scale. It's certainly not perfect, and I would never say that it's perfect. It has real problems. Yeah, Corey.
There was also a little discussion, Jim, about fire regime departure. So I thought I might just take a minute to give a little bit of background on that, because I think it's important and maybe a little bit confusing. So the concepts that Jim has been talking about are well documented in something called the Fire Regime Condition Class Guidebook, which you can find online. And it's a little bit dated, but there's really, really good quality information in here and background on a lot of the stuff we're talking about. And so when you go into the guidebook, what you'll find is the way Fire Regime Condition Class was originally designed is that it has two components, a departure component, a vegetation departure component, and a fire regime departure component. And you can put those together to calculate what's called fire regime condition class. LANDFIRE has always measured vegetation departure, not fire regime departure. We originally delivered the product, which measured vegetation departure. We delivered it, but we called it fire regime departure, fire regime condition class. It was really confusing. As you can imagine. And so we renamed it Veg Departure after a few versions to represent what it really is. So anyway, if you want more information on fire regime departure, you can get that here in the Fire Regime Condition Class Guidebook, as well as a lot of really good information on veg departure.
And I'll add to that, Corey, is we originally hoped as a part of LANDFIRE to actually create fire regime condition class, but learned that the data necessary to actually derive fire regime departure across the country was just not there. It just is not there consistently across the country. So that's why that particular component of the metric itself was dropped. We just could not find a way to do that without making tons of assumptions, which we think invalidated the interpretation of the product itself. And I think that's still true today. I still think we'd still have trouble today, 20 years later, creating fire regime departure across the country consistently, but we're getting closer.
We're getting closer. And for those who are interested, there is a really good example in California. There's a publication out by Safford and others, Hugh Safford and others in California, and they call it PFRID, percent fire return interval departure. But again, there you can see where we're kind of falling short. It's a fire return interval departure. It's not a fire regime departure. And so it measures departure in frequency, but not severity. So it's challenging.
Yeah. Thanks for the question about that. And thanks for adding that in, Corey. I assume somebody would be wondering about that. So thanks for jumping in.
If you're interested in biophysical settings models for Alaska, you can go to landfire.gov and navigate to the biophysical settings models page and download models from many years ago, probably circa 2007, 2008, somewhere in there for Alaska. Now, at that time that those models were developed, we were working with a draft classification for ecological systems, which is the basis for biophysical settings. And in the last couple of years, that classification was heavily revised, and we had to overhaul the entire model set to deal with a new classification system. And we went through a process of review that lasted a few years. And we now have new Alaska biophysical settings models. They are ready to go and ready to deliver. We are just waiting for the mapping team to come up with a new map of the new biophysical settings classification in Alaska. So we're hoping that maybe in the next year, maybe this spring, we'll be able to deliver a revised set of Alaska biophysical settings models. But if you're interested in the current set, just go to landfire.gov.
And Corey, I would say that if Rick wants to see the new models, we can provide those to him, but understand they won't match LANDFIRE spatial data anymore. They basically right now are a standalone product that doesn't match anything else LANDFIRE does. But if you're interested in the models, we can certainly give them to you with that caveat, Rick.